So hello everyone. So in the last class we discussed about proof of work and why it really actually functions in the real world. So the good things are that it actually consumes energy and that cannot be faked. So this is about proof of work. So this is quite a remarkable thing, because something from the real world, something being done in the real world, is captured in the digital domain on a blockchain, right? So it's quite an ingenious idea that just by looking at a few bits, you can actually ensure that somebody has actually consumed a lot of energy somewhere in order to solve that puzzle, right? And that has many ramifications. For the security and also the, you know, things like the safety and the liveness of the Bitcoin blockchain, right? So this solves the Sybil problem. So what is the Sybil attack? So just if you recall, a Sybil attack is where somebody tries to pretend that he is many people when he is actually only one. So let's say that there is a single person. So he pretends to be many. And if you have a voting-based system for consensus, then this is very, very dangerous. Okay, so suppose you have an election. That's how we have where we use voting nowadays. And you want somebody to vote only once, and there's an obvious reason why. Because if he votes many times, he can decide who gets elected just on his own, right? Or he has an unfair advantage over other people. Right, so usually consensus-based mechanisms and distributed systems are voting-based, and later on in the course we will look at things like Raft. We will look at protocols Raft, PBFT. If there's time, we'll even look at Ziziva. I think it is spelled there. It may have a few more Zs. Okay, so these are voting-based. So there it's not permissionless. There it's totally a permission system. Only there are n people allowed to vote, and you look at the majority of votes and so on to decide what is the next block, right? But in a permissionless system, the Sybil problem was very, very difficult, or people thought impossible to solve. But proof of work does it in a way, in that you can't fake how much computing power you have. So instead of voting power based on identity, you have voting power based on computational or hashing power. Whoever invests more in hashing, he has more hardware. He gets more votes as to what is going to be the next block, let's say. Okay, so effectively we solve the Sybil problem using proof of work, because you can't fake your proof of work. So nobody with a certain amount of computing power can pretend to have many times that computing power. That is not possible, at least in a probabilistic or in an expected sense over a large period of time. Okay. So, but the negative part of proof of work is actually consuming energy, because it consumes a huge amount of energy. So Bitcoin itself, proof of work, consumes more power than, let's say, some small countries. Like some small European countries may use less power than the Bitcoin energy. Okay. But of course, consuming so much power also gives it its security. If it didn't consume that much power, then somebody may be able to launch a 51% attack. Okay. So we can't consume very little energy with proof of work, otherwise we are in trouble. Right? But people were wondering whether there's an alternative. Are there alternatives to proof of work in order to do consensus in a permissionless setting? So this is what people have been thinking for a lot of time, because it's such a huge waste of energy. If you think about it, you could do so much of useful stuff with that energy, right? You could, I mean, if you even used it for computation, you could use it for useful computation. Why do you just solve some, you know, problem of finding a hash less than a threshold? You know, can you use it, can you use the energy more efficiently? Or can you do something where you don't need to consume energy, right? So people have thought about this in different ways. They thought of doing useful computation, but that's a non-trivial problem to solve. I mean, because how do you know that somebody hasn't, if you come up with, if, so instead of saying you solve this hash problem, suppose you give some real computation to do. Okay, somebody wants to solve a mathematical problem or something. I mean, how do you know that that problem already hasn't been solved, you know, in a permissionless system, because somebody could exploit. Okay, but today we are going to look at proof of stake. Okay, S stands for stake, which does not use energy at all. Okay, so it seems to be an ingenious idea, and people have been toying with the idea of using proof of stake, and there may be some blockchains which use proof of stake, maybe not so well known ones. But Ethereum is trying to move to proof of stake. So Ethereum 2.0 is trying to use proof of stake. But as we'll see, using proof of stake is non-trivial. There are issues which come up which are not there in proof of work. Okay, but it's an interesting idea in that it consumes zero energy. So let's think, how can we do it without energy? You know, so first of all, let's think how proof of work is performing. How does it work? So proof of work uses a resource, which in this time, in this, essentially it's computational resource. Let's say computational power, which is related to also to energy. Okay, and it solves a puzzle which is very hard to fake. I mean, you can't easily find it without actually using a lot of energy. And this, because of that, we solve the Sybil problem, right? And so can we come up with some other resource which cannot be faked? Okay, so you might want to think for a moment, is there a resource which all the people who are in the blockchain and who are using that they will not, I mean, they all agree on, and which can be used to solve the Sybil problem? Okay. So let's think about it. So we have a blockchain starting from the Genesis block. So Satoshi's idea was clever. He took the real world and he sort of got some information here about the energy being used using this proof of work puzzle. Right, and that sort of took care of the Sybil problem. So is there some other resource other than energy which can be used to do consensus and solve the Sybil problem? So everybody in the Bitcoin network, for example, agrees to the energy used in order to solve the puzzle, right? So based on the target threshold, you know what sort of, roughly what sort of energy has been used. Is there some other resource they agree on, okay, which they can agree on? So the idea in proof of stake is, why do you look at something external? Why not look at resource which is there internal to these blocks? So what is there inside the block? What sort of resource is there? And the resource is actually the cryptocurrency there. So things like your Bitcoin or your Ether and so on. Ether is the cryptocurrency used in the Ethereum blockchain. So why not use that resource? Can we use that resource in order to decide what the next block is going to be? And this currency in the blockchain is called stake. So in the proof of stake lingo, it's called stake. Okay, so it's sort of like if you want to sort of gamble, let's say, right, and you put something, if something is at stake, you put that up for, let's say, for your bet or whatever like that, right? So it's basically essentially how much stake you have in the system, and the more cryptocurrency you have, the higher your stake is in the system. Okay, so let's say you have users. And the amount of Bitcoin that they have. So let's say this is A, B, C, and so on. And let's say A has 5, B has 10, C has 3 Bitcoin, and so on. So this is their stake which they have. So this is the stake that A, B, and C have. They have different amounts of stake. So can we use this in some sort of voting mechanism? Instead of using energy, can we use this? Okay. So how could we do it? Let's think about it for a moment. So so suppose we give the voting power proportional to the stake that they have. Suppose A has 5 votes, B has 10 votes, and C has 3 votes, right? And effectively it means the richer person, the person with more cryptocurrency, has more voting power. Okay, but that's fine. In Bitcoin, the person who has more computational power, he gets more votes, he can create more blocks. Here what we are saying is whoever has more cryptocurrency can generate more blocks. Okay. But it does solve the Sybil problem, because each person cannot really fake how much cryptocurrency he has. So this cannot be faked. So it solves the Sybil problem. Okay, so that's the idea. So in proof of work, you're using computational power or energy, whereas in proof of stake, the resource that you're using is the cryptocurrency which is there on the blockchain itself. Okay, so proof of work is using a resource from the external world, external to the blockchain. You're consuming energy externally and recording it in the form of solutions to a puzzle. Here you're saying, why do I need to look to the external world to solve the Sybil problem? I've already agreed on how much Bitcoin or Ether or whatever different people own. So why not use that agreed upon resource, which nobody can fake because it's there in the blockchain. So use that in order to give people voting power in order to create future blocks. So let's see how that might be done. So what we want to do is something like proof of work. You want to have a random person selected to generate each block. So how to actually do proof of stake? So POW chooses a random winner every time. And this sort of takes care of liveness to some extent, so that no, it's not biased that you give, let's say, control of the several blocks, too many blocks, to a particular miner, because then he might be biased and leave out somebody's transaction. Here you sort of have a random person winning, and so once in a while you will get an honest miner who will include transactions of somebody else, right? So this, can we have a similar property but using stake rather than energy or computational power? So let's see how that is done. So proof of work, what do? We say that hash so hash of the previous block and we have a nonce and we have timestamp and a few other things. Then what else did we have? Merkle root. And you know, a few other things. And we say this should be less than the target. So proof of stake, we are going to do something similar. So suppose let's say that you had a particular user. Suppose you had public key A. And this public key had a particular amount of cryptocurrency, which I am going to call balance of A. Okay, so that is the stake that A has. Okay. So this has to be done carefully so that if somebody splits up this balance into multiple accounts, it doesn't give him more voting power, right? So we want his voting power should be proportional to the balance that he has. Okay, so let's see how this particular person who has this particular public key is going to try to create a block. So we say hash of, okay, so this is the previous block, I should say previous block hash. Previous hash, okay, that we've got to do. Now how do I do this, right? So I can't have something like a nonce as such, because then it becomes proof of work. I can't have something that in here which the miner can arbitrarily change, okay, because otherwise, you know, what I want is something like this. I want something similar. Right, so I definitely want a target so that I can space out blocks every 10 minutes. Right, so that should be adjustable based on the previous number of blocks that were created and so on. Okay. But at the same time, I don't want something that can be arbitrarily changed here, because then it reduces to proof of work. Okay. So clearly I can't have a Merkle root over here, because Merkle root can be changed. I change something a little bit in the transactions that I include and the Merkle root changes. So this cannot go here. Okay. So what else can I put? Can I put a timestamp? Let's think about it. So what I So definitely I need to put some information about time, because I need that in order to compute the target later on. Every, let's say, 2 weeks or something, I may want to update the target. So I need some sort of timestamp. But at the same time, I can't have arbitrary resolution of the timestamp. So what should I include about the time here? So let me just say that we put some time information, but obviously you can't have arbitrary time resolution, I mean, with lots and lots of bits, because again, people will be able to change, let's say, the millisecond or the microsecond value, let's say, in this timestamp. You could change it millions and millions of times and try to solve the problem. Okay? So we definitely need some notion of time here. So now what else do I put here? I mean, so since I'm not allowed proof of work, okay, and we said that somehow the voting power of the person has to depend on the balance that he has, right? And so how do we do that? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this address here. Let's say it's the public key of the person. And that's all the information. Let's say that these three I allow. So let's say that time is progressing like this. And this is the current time. So this is the current time, and it's moving, to the right here. Time is progressing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say that this time, let's say, can have a particular window, let's say, beyond the current time, or let's say there's some plus or minus range. So let's say plus or minus 1 hour is allowed for the time. You can't put any, if you put a time that is too far in the past or too much in the future, whatever, then that won't be allowed. Of course, you can also have a different range, maybe whatever, plus or minus. This is just an example. And let's say that you have only seconds resolution. So that gives me 7200 values that I can try here. Okay, at this particular time, let's say, I can try 7200 values. Okay, so 7200 still has a limit, it's not an arbitrary number that you can try. You try out those 7200 values and you see if it is less than the target. You plug in your address and you see if it is less than the target. Okay? And let's say that the target is quite small, and so because of that, what happens is that let's say that you don't win the game. Okay? And of course, other miners are also doing the same thing. They are plugging in their own addresses. So these addresses and the balance are given by the blockchain, right? All the previous blocks. Everybody knows which addresses have how much balance. So they try to keep solving this problem, and let's say that the first person who wins creates the block. Okay, so let's say nobody is able to solve the problem here, so the timeline shifts to the right, and then somebody creates the block because this timestamp is progressing. You can try out more and more values, and then somebody creates the block. So this is one idea for proof of stake, but there's a slight issue over here. So suppose somebody keeps dividing this balance into smaller and smaller balances. Suppose he splits it up into, let's say he splits up the money into many accounts, A1, A2, A3, and so on. Right? So now he's getting more tries to create the block. Right? He's able to put in more addresses. He's running this in parallel. Right? And he's able to create the block. Right? So of course, when he creates the block, he would have to give this information in it. He would have to put this all the values which I've shown here. All this will go into the block header. But this sort of doesn't really solve the CIBIL problem, because somebody, by just dividing his balance into more and more accounts, is going to get a better chance of cracking the problem, right? So obviously I need something more, and that is that I have to multiply this by the balance of account A. Okay, so this target is common to all. But what changes for each miner is this balance amount that he puts on the right. Okay, so what he's going to do is, now let's just change it a little bit. So he's going to put this entire quantity on the right hand side. Somebody, let's say with more money, has a bigger right hand side, so he can solve the problem more easily, right? So that's what we said, somebody who has more stake should be given more voting power, right? And so he's going to now try to solve this problem. He, as time progresses, he tries out more and more values of time until he is able to solve the problem, or until somebody else solves the problem and sends out a block, right? So if somebody else sends out the block, then he has to solve a new problem where he replaces this previous hash with the hash of the new block. Okay, and so this is how the game continues. So you might say, I mean, is it really solving the CIBIL problem? And it, in fact, it can be proved that if you divide your balance into multiple accounts, you're not really going to give yourself a higher chance of winning. Right? So suppose I split it into two accounts, A1 and A2. Now I have two problems, but the right hand side has decreased by amounts proportional to that, right? So if I've split my balance into half into A1 and half into A2, now I have two smaller right hand sides, right? And I'm sort of flipping coins, as so to speak, or as I try out a new value of time, I now have two problems to solve, but the right hand side has also decreased appropriately. Okay, so it doesn't really give me any particular gain. Okay, so proof of stake does solve a CIBIL problem. Okay, that you can't have voting power more than the stake that you have. Okay, so does it give us a random winner every time, like in proof of work? Let's think about it. So this previous hash, well, suppose it was not under the control of a miner. Right, and in fact, in proof of work, that is true, because even somebody who wins the game hasn't really pre-decided that exact value. I mean, he's just thankful that he got something less than the target and he sends it out, right? So it's like a random number between 0 and the target, and he has sent it out. So nobody really had control over that, right? And seemingly this is doing that. I mean, somebody wins the game, right? Somebody wins the game, and then whatever comes out, that is the hash value which you have to put in the next one. Okay, but let's put a question mark over here and let's think a little bit whether somebody could perform an attack and maybe control the hash value that comes in. Okay, so seemingly proof of stake actually has some good properties, in that we are able to solve the CIBIL attack, because you can think that voting, so it's not exactly voting, but roughly the blocks you generate are proportional to your stake which you have. So I shouldn't say, so fraction of blocks generated is proportional to the stake head. Okay. And whether there is a random winner every time, it appears to be so. Okay. okay, but let's still put a question mark because maybe we haven't thought things through well enough. Okay. So let's think for a moment how, let's say, we are going to resolve forks. So let's say this is a blockchain and we progressed a little bit. It might happen that we are running proof of stake and then we have a fork like before, and maybe it's rare enough because one block every 10 minutes, rarely might generate a fork. But it might happen, and then how do we resolve this problem? So Satoshi said, you just choose to mine on the block which you saw first, if you're an honest miner. And of course, an attacker might just decide to stick to one of them, irrespective of whether he saw it earlier or not. So the proof of work got divided. Proof of work, you had to choose between one of the two. Okay, and it was like a random choice, one of them was going to win the game. Right? And whichever one got extended, that became the longest chain, and this one got killed. Right? Now let's think for a moment in proof of stake, what is going to happen? So we have a fork. So now we can say an honest miner has to mine on only one of them. Okay, on whichever one that he saw first. But suppose he's not completely honest, suppose he's rational, or even if he's malicious. So let's think about it. So every time somebody creates a block, you give him some mining fee. Some small mining fee, of course, in proof of work, so that it incentivizes him. Okay? So you don't have to give as large a mining fee in proof of stake compared to proof of work because there is no energy consumed. Okay, so here you at least have to pay him for the energy that he's used. So there has to be some reasonable mining fee and whatnot, right? And you want to have enough of energy consumed so that the system is secure. Here, people are not consuming energy. So why should you give them a huge amount of mining fee, right? But you give them a little bit so that they actually do it. Otherwise, nobody would be incentivized to do proof of stake. They would just be offline and no blocks would be created. So think about, we have a miner and the miner sees a fork. Now he doesn't know which chain is going to win. You never know. Let's say that this one somebody might create a chain or whatever, somebody might create a longer chain. So why choose? Why not try to extend both? So extend both branches. So this becomes a big issue because really, what is the miner to lose? So here, of course, he has some amount of hashing power and he has to devote it to one or the other chain. Of course, he could divide his hashing power equally between them, right? But here there is no hashing, I mean, no heavy hashing being done. You just have to try out a few number of you have to just try out a few number of timestamps which are allowed here. And of course, you could, try it on both the chains. You just put both of, you try out, you put one previous hash corresponding to one chain, and you put another previous hash corresponding to the second chain, and you try out all those timestamp values. I mean, it's not a big deal. You only are allowed a few of them anyway. Right? So somebody can actually mine on both branches without putting in any extra effort away without spending much resources. And this is called the nothing at stake problem. So it is a serious problem in proof of stake, in that people might extend multiple chains. What's the harm? I mean, so what, you try to extend both the chains, you might create a block, or somebody else created a block. Let's say that this is the situation. Even if this chain is longer, you never know, right? Maybe somebody has generated a block which is in flight over here or whatever. You never know which one is going to become the longest one, and you don't care. You want to generate blocks in both, so that whichever one wins, you get mining fees in it. Right? You're sort of a selfish person. You want to make money no matter what. So you just keep mining on both the chains. And this is a sort of situation which may happen, right? And even if this one forks, people might still keep creating blocks on all branches, and it costs no effort, right? So everybody mines on all branches, and he hopes that, so that no matter which branch actually becomes the longest one, or if at all it is resolved finally, he will have blocks in all the chains, and he will get some mining fees. Okay. So there is, unlike proof of work where you actually have to choose between chains, depending on which one you have, you can't extend all of them with equal strength, so to speak. Here you can do that without any effort. Okay, and this is a major issue, because then which becomes the final chain? All the branches keep getting extended arbitrarily, for long amounts of time. Okay. So this is a very serious problem. So already we've encountered one problem, right? And when you want to resolve forks, nothing at stake might kick in, and the forks might go on forever. So this is one issue, but are there other problems? Right? So we seemingly solved the problem, but we're getting into trouble over here. So let's think about it. So let's look at the long range attack. So let's say that this is the blockchain. We've started from the Genesis block and we've come up to here. So suppose what somebody wants to do, an attacker wants to do, is to kill a large part of the chain. Let's say he wants to orphan a large part of the chain. Right? So he wants to create a chain like this, which is longer, and he kills this entire chain. Okay. So what does he gain by this? Well, if all these blocks are created by him, then he has a lot of Bitcoin, right, which he can spend. Let's say he wants really lots of it. But of course, he's doing a lot of damage by killing all these blocks, because then all these transactions are gone. And maybe he can get their transaction fees or whatever he wants to bring down the system of. So this sort of an attack is very hard to do in a proof of work system, because we said that the entire proof of work of this chain should be there in this one. Right? So you actually have to put in that much computation. So for example, for the Bitcoin blockchain, it would be virtually impossible for somebody to do this on his own. Right? Even a government might take a lot of time if he wants to do a long range attack starting from somewhere from the Genesis block. Okay, a few blocks behind, of course, maybe the a government with higher, maybe 50% of the hashing power can do it, right? But even if you have 50% of the hashing power of Bitcoin and you want to fork somewhere from the Genesis block, it might take you a while, maybe if a few months or whatever, right? Or a year or something to generate a very long chain. But can we do this sort of an attack in proof of stake? Let's see whether it's easy or hard to do. So suppose an attacker has 10% of the hashing power, let's say. not the hashing power. Suppose he has 10% of the stake. So early enough in the chain, in you know, let's say he has 10% of the stake. So can he generate this block? Let's think about it. And yeah, I mean, he tries it out, you know, whatever, he puts the previous hash value and he tries to crack the problem. So there's a previous hash, there is the his balance, no, not his balance, his account, and his he's allowed to try out a few of these. There is some target and that he multiplies by his balance. Okay. So he tries out a few timestamps, and instead of let's say solving the problem in 10 minutes, it might take him 100 minutes because he has only 10% of the stake. Right? So all of this is being done privately. Right? So it may take him 10 minutes, but he doesn't. So let's say that he is starting the attack at this point in time, right? This is the current state of the blockchain. He's gone all the way back in time. He's trying to fork from here. So he just has to try out a lot of these time values. I mean, he doesn't actually have to wait 100 minutes. He just tries them out and he finds a timestamp value so that he is able to actually create this block. So he does it quite easily, right? He, instead of trying out 7200 values, and he can try out lots of values in the future corresponding to this, right? So he's sort of going back in time and trying out those timestamp values which are allowed here. So very quickly he creates this block. Of course, it represents a timestamp maybe which is further into time than here. Let's say that this block was created at T0. So this block would roughly be created at T0 plus 600 seconds, let's say. Right? And this one he might actually have to try out up to T0 plus 6000. Okay, because he just has a smaller balance, 10% of the total stake. Right? Okay, so what? I mean, he just tries out lots of timestamps, okay, till he solves the problem. And then he continues, right? And this may be roughly created at T0 plus 12,000, right? Because he has 10% of the stake, right? But what happens is that his stake is going up because he is getting the mining fees. So the attacker's stake goes up. Okay, so that's something different that which is happening over here. That okay, so here he is able to get, let's say, a little bit. He gets, let's say, 1% or whatever. It might go up to 11%. Of course, 1% may be high. Maybe he gets much smaller depending on the rules of the blockchain. But effectively, his stake is going up. And maybe by somewhere here, he has 20% of the stake. Just because he's got a lot of mining fees. So with timestamps which are less than 6000 seconds apart, he's able to solve the problem. Now it may take 3000 seconds, let's say, between blocks. So this is not real time. I'm just saying that the timestamp that he puts in here might be only 3000 seconds apart. And by the time he reaches here, he may actually have 100% of the stake. Okay. So he is able to generate timestamps. So he might actually be able to create a longer chain by the time he reaches the present day timestamps. Right? And he's able to create these. And because of that, he might be able to generate a longer chain, in which he has most of the stake. Okay. So let me just write that down. So the timestamps in blocks will get closer to 10 minutes, let's say in consecutive blocks. As his stake grows up, as stake of the attacker goes up. So he is going to be able to win the game if he can actually create a longer chain, and let's say the last block has a timestamp something close to the present day time, right? If it is something very much in the future or then people may not accept that particular block, right? But he might be able to do that. So let's say within 100 blocks or so, he is actually able to get a very high stake. And he is able to quickly generate blocks. I mean, with, he doesn't have to try out timestamps so far in time, and he creates blocks up there. Right? So what I mean to say is, let's say that these are the timestamps that they are putting in. And let's say that we are starting out from zero. So roughly you have timestamps in each block, let's say increasing by 10 minutes in the main chain. So the attacker might initially have to use a timestamp which is larger, very high, but then he sort of might be able to catch up to something closer just because his stake is going up. Right, and he's able to win the game. Okay, so this is a problem because if his timestamp here is, let's say, close to the real day time, he can actually release his chain and kill this chain. People will accept it. Okay, so this is a serious problem that somebody with no effort at all, provided he had a little bit of stake in the beginning, can create a longer chain than the honest miners who are following all the rules. Okay, and he can kill a very large portion of the chain. Okay, so of course we haven't looked at the full scope of attacks, so we are just looking at them piece by piece, and maybe you can combine these attacks to do something even more dangerous. Right, he could create multiple forks here, for example, using a nothing at stake sort of a situation and so on. Okay, so this is one more issue compared to proof of work. Proof of stake has this long range problem. So then there is something called initial distribution problem. So in proof of work, there was a separation between users and miners. So like in Bitcoin, for somebody to have Bitcoin or to spend Bitcoin, he doesn't have to be a miner. It's a totally different thing, because mining you need hardware and you solve a computational problem. Yeah, of course, miners can be users. They earn a little bit of Bitcoin every Coinbase, and they can spend that, right? But every user doesn't have to be, may not be able to become a miner. Whereas in proof of stake, the separation gets blurred. So every user, anybody who has any amount of Bitcoin or whatever cryptocurrency there is in the blockchain, can become a miner. Right, he can try to solve that problem. Right? So where is that? Right, so he can just try to solve this problem. He plugs in his address and he plugs in his balance. So there is a small issue over here that if somebody spends his money, he has less chance to win blocks. Someone who spends his currency has less chance to win. Okay, so this is an issue. Okay, so if you lock up your money, if you don't spend it, I mean, you become a miser, and you all you try to do is you try to solve this proof of stake because you get even more mining fees, okay, and you become richer. But then you will sort of, I mean, you'll end up not spending, and it could be that everybody is like this. All users just try to create the next block. Right? So this is the blockchain. Everybody is bothered about trying to create the next block and they don't want to spend their money. Okay, so it's almost like you put your money into, if you get into mining in proof of stake, it's almost like you put your money into a big fixed deposit which gives you a lot of money, right? Let's say the interest rate is very high. And so why spend it at all? Okay, so you've got this bank where if you put your money, they give you a lot of interest. So you don't want to spend it at all, you just want to make even more and more money. Okay, so suppose somebody has, let's say, X percentage of stake here at some particular point. He would want to continue in mining so that he has, and he wants to keep that X stake. Okay, so person who, if he mines and everybody, let's say everybody else mines, he would still have X percentage. But if some people don't mine, then he would actually end up with greater than X percent. So this is if some users don't mine. Okay, but of course if he doesn't mine, then he's going to get less. If he does not mine, other people are getting some mining fees, their stake is going up. So even if he doesn't mine, he's going to lose money, or if he spends, I can say even if he spends his money, then he's going to have less than X percentage, right? So sort of there's this issue over here, you're coupling stake with mining. So people are incentivized to just lock up their stake and only do mining with it and not spend it. Okay, so this is a issue, it's a psychological sort of problem that you have in proof of stake. You know, people don't want to spend their money, they would like to maintain their initial distribution of stake which they have. So what other problems can be there? So the next problem I want to talk about is the bribe attack, which is really an extension of the nothing at stake problem. So suppose this is the blockchain, you start from the Genesis block and we are here. Let's say lots of blocks have been created. So let's say a malicious person comes on the scene and he creates a chain, but his chain is not private, he is actually broadcasting these blocks. This is not private. Now, in a proof of work system, people would just ignore this I mean, they would think, you know, this is so much shorter than the longest chain, so let's forget about it. We just mine on the longest chain. But in this instant, he says that I am willing to offer you some money. I am going to offer you a bribe. Okay, so it doesn't cost you anything to mine on my chain, right? So he's like a tempter, right? He's sort of tempting people, and he says that, okay, if you create a block here, right, you will put some public key for in your Coinbase, right? So in the blocks that I am creating, you know, that whatever, I am going to give you some money myself. I'm going to share some money with you. And that can be done in a guaranteed way based on a smart contract, right? So we haven't talked about smart contracts much, but essentially a smart contract is a program . So it's just a piece of code which you put as a transaction in the blockchain, right? And it can have some logic in it. So maybe the smart contract says that whoever creates a block here in subsequent to this is going to get some money, right? Whatever. And I'll transfer some money with this smart contract. Or whoever creates it here can actually take some money from which is locked in the smart contract for himself. That is allowed, right? So this person offers a bribe to people, and he says, see, it doesn't cost you anything. Why don't you extend my chain? So he is generating some blocks, but other people also generate some blocks. And they think, you know, I mean, it doesn't cost us anything. We can still generate blocks here, right? We can ourselves generate blocks here. I mean, and we don't have to worry about switching over here. So they join the bribe attack, because you never know, maybe this will end up as the longest chain and they don't want to lose out, right? They want this money plus they want some mining fees. Okay, so it's an extension of the nothing at stake problem. It doesn't cost anybody to mine on multiple chains, right? And the bribe attack might succeed more easily here than it would in the proof of work system. In the proof of work system, somebody could still say that I'm offering people money to mine on my chain, you know. But people will say that even if we mine on your chain, you know, the honest miners are only going to extend this longest chain. So we might anyway not get any money from your chain, right? Because it's never going to catch up with the honest chain. And they are losing out over there in the proof of work, because they can only choose between one of the chains. If they are doing hashing on this chain of the attacker, they cannot extend the honest chain. Right, and they might end up losing if it doesn't catch up with the honest chain. So there is some hesitancy in this sort of an attack in the proof of work, but here there is no problem. People can just join it, because even if they lose out, this chain doesn't catch up, they don't lose anything. Right? So the bribe attack is an extension of the nothing at stake problem, and it's easier for a bribe attack to succeed in proof of stake. So there are further problems. And one is called the pre-computing attack. So I think we get to appreciate Satoshi's solution of proof of work the more we look at these alternatives. Right? He must have thought things through well enough and figured out that proof of work is really going to work. Whereas these other alternatives can easily be broken in many different ways. Okay, so let's just recall what is proof of stake. So we take hash of the hash of the previous block. Timestamp here, and this was had to be less than the target multiplied by the balance. So this is proof of stake. Now let's think about it. What can we do I mean, over here, what sort of an attack is possible? So let's say that this is the blockchain. Let's say that this is BK minus 1, BK and so on, right? BK plus. So we were assuming that every time you get sort of a random number over here, okay, that's why I put a question mark earlier in the presentation. Do we really have a random winner every time, or somebody can somebody really have control over what happens over here, what hash value comes up? So there is actually a fundamental problem here, and that earlier what Satoshi did was he had a Merkle root over here for the transactions, right? And so sort of the what transactions you could put in a block was sort of fixed, I mean, in some way. I mean, you couldn't just try out, even if you tried any particular different transaction, you put a different transaction, that would change this value over here. But here we've sort of decoupled it. We said we don't want anybody to be able to change a transaction and change this problem, because then it reduces to proof of work. Okay, so how are we going to say what transactions have gotten here in the block? Right? It seems a little bit weird. I mean, and really what we have is that suppose somebody is creating the block, he can put any set of transactions, it seems, here. Okay, so somebody can, let's say somebody wins the game, right, for this particular block. So this block also has transactions. So he takes the entire hash, let's say, and puts it over here. Okay, so this is sort of a way of making it tamper proof, right? So eventually there has to be some hash information about the transactions, because otherwise if you just have hash of the block headers which have no information about the transactions, then I mean, how is a blockchain tamper proof, right? You can put any transactions here. So the way you would do it in proof of stake is, although the while solving the problem you don't put that over here, still while putting in the next hash value or the previous hash value in the next block header, right, you put the hash of the entire block, the block header and the transaction. Okay, so let's say we do that. Okay, so then so to solve each problem you just have the hash of the previous block and so on, but you don't have any information about the transactions in the current block. Okay, so let's see what can be done here. So this person, let's say he cracks the problem, he puts the entire hash of the entire block, transactions and the block header, into his block header. He puts it over here, puts his address, tries out some timestamps, and let's say he's the first one to win it. Now there is he has an advantage, because let's say he doesn't reveal the full block, right? So let's say he's keeping it secret for the time being. And okay, so he's won the game over here, right? So this is what is there inside his block header over here. Okay, this is what this entire thing is there. Now he has control of what transactions he's put in. He is not committed to any transactions that for the time being. And of course we will have to come up with a scheme where he has to commit to the transactions, right? Okay. So how are we going to do this? So now let's say that he wants to do an attack. So he wants to give himself a chance to create this new block. So what does this have, the header? Let's say that I zoom in here. So this is the header and these are the transactions. So he's going to take the hash of the previous block, so this entire block, and now he plays mischief. So since he had the freedom to choose his transactions, he changes a few bits here, right? So this is locked. I mean, the block header is locked over here, and the hash of the block header is less than the target time balance. Right, but now he can tamper with the transaction, which was not possible in proof of work because the hash of the block was stored as a Merkle root over here. Okay. But here it is not stored because we wanted to not boil this down to a proof of work sort of scenario. Right, so he can change a few bits here and he can change the hash here. Right, arbitrarily, and he has A and the timestamp over here. So now he's left with something like a proof of work situation. He arbitrarily changes these values over here and he is able to get this less than the target times the balance. Okay. Of course, his balance has gone up a little bit because of the mining fees, let's say, that he is able to get. Okay. So this has given him a lot of control, and so he doesn't broadcast this block. So suppose there was a commitment scheme, you know, some way to penalize him if he sent out two different sets of transactions which corresponded to this same block header. Okay. So he keeps the secret and then he solves this problem, right? And then he continues. Since there is no coupling between these transactions and here, he tampers with the transactions so that he is able to change this hash value arbitrarily, like a proof of work system. He tries out lots of them, wins the game, creates this block and so on. Okay. So he can generate a large set of blocks, okay, succeeding from any particular block which he won. Right? He keeps all of this secret and then he broadcasts this chain. Okay, so he pre-computes the hash to be there in succeeding blocks by tweaking the transactions in the previous blocks, right? And he wins the game for several future blocks. So he pre-computes hash in next block. Okay, so it seems to be a catch-22 sort of situation. No matter what you do, there is some problem or the other. We wanted to decouple transactions from this so that you could actually solve a problem which and you didn't sort of require a lot of energy for it. Okay, if you had a hash over here corresponding to transactions, then it would become proof of work, right? You change the transaction and you can crack the problem faster, right? By trying out different transactions. So we didn't want that. We wanted a less energy consumption sort of based algorithm. So we decoupled those, but then it gave you, I mean, then there was a problem. How do you get tamper-proof nature of blockchain, right? There has to be some information about the transactions in the block headers, right? So if we included that in, say, let's say if we included the transactions, we included the hash which included both block header and transaction in the next block, then it gave somebody power to change this. Okay, and he launched a pre-computing attack. Right, so proof of stake, though it's a very nice idea and seemingly solved the Sybil problem, there is a nothing at stake problem, there is a long range attack, there is an initial distribution problem, there's a bribe attack, there's a pre-computing problem, right? And who knows what sorts of other attacks are possible, right? So in the next lecture, we'll look at some potential solutions. And so people say, let's combine proof of work with proof of stake. So that might be a better solution. And of course, people have thought of pure proof of work, proof of stake solutions. There is something called Algorand, created by a Turing Award winner named Mikali. I believe he's a prof at MIT, right? So Algorand is a big idea But of course, the threat model in Algorand that Algorand considers is somewhat restrictive, right? So they assume that something like 85% of the people who own the currency, or 85% of the currency in the blockchain, is owned by purely honest people, right? They are complete angels. They are not even rational trying to maximize their profit, right? But anyway, in the next class, we'll look at combinations of proof of work and proof of stake. So Algorand is a pure stake-based solution, right? So of course, it doesn't use the same algorithm that we have here. It does something else, right? But in the next lecture, we'll look at solutions which try to use both, so that you have some of the benefits of proof of work, which will kill many of these problems, but at the same time, you don't consume too much energy, right? And you do that by using proof of stake.